In this session, we'll be studying now the construction of phase portraits. So far we have seen what a phase portrait is and how we can analyze, how we can actually extend the concept of stability generated that we have already defined for a linear system to that of a phase portrait. Now, as far as the construction of phase portrait is concerned, mostly and in we know that in today's age, this type of the construction of phase portrait is easily done using computer softwares, but we have, for this course, we as a control engineer, one needs to be able to roughly sketch, be able to sketch the phase portrait of a system on a paper. As far as phase portraits go, there are a number of methods that can be used for that are actually adopted, that have been actually over the years been in the literature. You'll see that a number of researchers have given their ideas regarding the construction of phase portraits. There is the method of isoclines, there is the delta method, there is the Lenard's method, the Pell's method, so we have analytical methods, method of, you have graphical methods like isoclines, delta, Pell's method, and Lenard's method. We'll not be taking up all of these. We'll be looking at some of these. We'll be looking at some of these methods and how we can portray, how we can sketch a portrait of any nonlinear dynamic system using these methods. Now I will be starting with the analytical method. We understand that a phase portrait is actually in itself a graphical tool, a graphical analysis of a nonlinear system, and it adopts graphs to analyze the behavior of nonlinear system. What we do in case of analytical method is we arrive at certain solutions. We have a nonlinear differential equation. We can solve it analytically using mathematical tools that are available to us and obtain a solution of the system, and that solution can be sketched with respect to time so that we obtain the phase portrait of a system. So this here involves mathematical operations, the analytical method, and we need to arrive at we need to be able to solve the nonlinear dynamic equation, the nonlinear differential equation. So now where we find the use of analytical solutions, we basically most often we'll see the analytical solution being adopted for such systems that are actually, that can be defined via piecewise linearity. Those nonlinear systems that can be treated as piecewise linear systems, for such systems obtaining an analytical solution becomes easier as compared to those hard non-linearities, where finding an analytical solution will not be easy to obtain. So in such systems where piecewise linearity is possible, where linearization is possible, where the method of piecewise obtaining piecewise linear systems, in such cases analytical solutions can be derived. So what we do in case of analytical method is, say for example, we have a system, a nonlinear system, that is described by we have a nonlinear system which is actually defined using this function g of x1 x2 c equal to 0, where x1 x2 are the state variables of a system. We are talking about phase portraits, so we are restricting to second order differential equations. And C, as far as C goes, it involves both the input U as well as taking into considerations the initial conditions of the system. So this C has both U, it takes account of both U, the input, as well as the initial conditions of the system. So we have a system G of x1, x2 equal, this is a nonlinear system. Now what analytical method does is, we can solve this in two ways. One method is solve this equation for x1 so that we obtain a function that is that will be a function g1, so that we get a solution of x1 that will be a function of x1, x2 and time t. We'll obtain the solution of x2 that will be a function of x1, x2 and t. So what we are doing is, we have a nonlinear differential equation g x1 x2 c equal to 0. That differential equation can be solved to obtain the solutions x1 t and x2 t. Both of them, they are actually functions of x1, x2 and t. So we have obtained the function x1 with respect to time t. We have obtained the function x2 with respect to time t. Once we have the plots of both x1t and x2t, eliminating t from these equations will actually lead to a function that will be from which we can actually then be able to plot x1 with respect to x2. Fine. So first of all, plot x1 with respect to time, plot x2 with respect to time, actually obtain the solution of x1 with respect to time, x2 with respect to time. Eliminating t from these, we can obtain x1 versus x2. In the second method, what we can do is, instead of obtaining the solutions x1t and x2t, we have two differential equations, x1 dot and x2 dot. So we can simply divide those two differential equations. We have dx2 by dt, we have dx1 by dt. That's actually the state space model of a nonlinear system. So dividing x2 dot by x1 dot, we'll be actually eliminating dt so that we obtain dx2 by dx1. Fine. So again, these will be actually the functions of x1, x2 and t, f of f1, f2, x1, x2 and t. So once we have obtained this dx2 by dx1, we can directly solve this differential equation so that we'll be able to get a plot between x1 with respect to x2. Fine. Directly solving for dx2 by dx1, we can obtain a plot of x2 with respect to x1. That is actually x1 versus x2 plot. So any of these two methods can be used for plotting the for obtaining the analytical solution of any system. So we'll be looking at some examples, and through examples we'll try to see how phase portrait of any nonlinear system is. We can plot how we can actually analytically plot how we can obtain an analytical solution, and using that analytical solution be able to sketch a phase portrait of a system. Now the example that we'll be taking is that of a satellite control system. So what we have in this case, in a satellite control system, the block diagram of the system looks something like this. So the design, the block diagram here that we have is that of a satellite control system. This here represents our satellite. So we are simply modeling the satellite as a rotational unit. And this here, our control jet or thrusters extra. Is you can say it's a type of on-off controller or a bang-bang controller. So the purpose of our control system is to maintain the angle of the satellite at zero, and this can be possible by appropriately firing the controller. So the controller either gives us a positive torque when it is equal to U, or it gives us a negative torque when it is equal to minus U. So it can actually produce a positive angle or a negative angle depending upon the thrust or the torque that is being provided from the control unit. The satellite model is simply we are only controlling the angle of the satellite. It's a rotational unit. So looking at this example, what we have is our output from the controller UT is either plus U or it's equal to minus U, and this will be equal to plus U when theta will be greater than zero, and it will be equal to minus U when theta will be less than zero. And theta will be less than zero, then it will be positive U, so that actually it brings it back to plus 0 degrees. And theta is greater than zero, we will be applying a negative controller action, so that theta moves back towards zero. Right? This is our control law, and therefore we can now define the dynamics of the system. You can simply see what is U equal to. It is equal to theta double dot, or you can say theta double dot is equal to u. D square theta by dt square is equal to u. Now it can either be positive u or it can be negative u. So say for example, first case, we are taking this equal to positive u. Now in that case, therefore theta double dot is equal to plus u. I write this as capital U. So theta double dot is now equal to positive u. That implies d theta into so what I am doing is I am multiplying both sides by d theta by dt, and dt actually cancels out. So one hand I have theta dot, and this theta double dot can be written as d theta dot. So multiplying both sides by d theta by dt, dt dt cancels actually out. So this on this side theta dot into d theta dot is equal to u into d theta. Now therefore this becomes equal to theta dot square equal to 2 u theta on integration. Once we integrate this, theta dot into d theta dot, integration of this is equal to theta dot square, and on this side this will be u into the integration of d theta will be theta only, this also divided by 2, that 2 goes here, plus in constant of integration, that is equal to c. Fine. So integrating this we obtain theta dot square is equal to 2 u theta plus c, rather at c1, where c1 is actually the constant of integration. Now this here theta dot square equal to 2 u theta plus c1 actually represents the trajectory from the family of parabolas that can be plotted in this fashion. So depending upon the value of c1, we'll be obtaining these plots. Fine. So this is your plot between x1 and x2, that in this case was actually theta 1 and theta 1 dot. Now for the another case where now theta double dot will be equal to minus u, we'll come up with the solution theta dot square equal to minus 2 u theta plus c2, where c2 is another constant of integration. Again this represents when we plot this, we are plotting x theta dot with respect to theta. This actually is theta dot, that is actually x2 in this case, and this is theta, that is actually is x1. Fine. So we are actually plotting x1 with respect to x2, but for this particular case, that is x1 is theta and x2 is theta dot square. So I can actually write this as x2 square is equal to minus 2u x1 plus c2. So I have to plot x1 with respect to x2, and this equation actually represents the equation of a parabola with these types of curves that we will be obtaining in this particular case. So depending on the value of c2, it will shift towards the right. Now we have to plot the complete phase portrait of the system. Now in a closed loop system, both it will be switching between u and plus u and minus u. So what we'll be having for our closed loop system, the phase portrait of the system will be this will be the phase trajectory of the system. Now depending upon the value of c, these will be the phase trajectories. Fine. So this will be the phase portrait of the system. So you have a satellite control system which is actually controlled using an on-off switch controller. On-off switch controller, what it does is it produces an output of plus u for theta less than 0. It produces an output of minus u for theta greater than 0. We can directly see from here that u is equal to actually theta double dot. Theta double dot is equal to now either plus u or minus u, capital U. It's either plus u or minus u. So having this equation, with this equation, what we can do is we can put it in this form as well. Theta dot into d theta dot is equal to u d theta. This equation, once we integrate this equation, on the left hand side we are integrating with respect to d theta dot, and what are we integrating? Theta dot. So that means actually this is integration of x dx. So x integration of x dx is x square by 2. So that means actually theta dot square by 2, and 2 goes on the right hand side. So integration of u d theta integration of u d theta is simply theta with a constant of integration, that is c1. So this is for the positive case. And here again, for this system, x1, one state is x1 is equal to theta, another state is x2 dot, x2 is equal to theta dot, or you can say x1 dot. So this equation is actually what? This is simply x2 square equal to 2 u x1 plus c1. So we can vary the value of x1 and see what x2 will be equal to, keeping c1 constant. And this actually represents the it's actually an equation that represents a parabola, and depending upon the value of c1, so this will be c1 c1 dash, c1 double dash, c1 triple dash, so whatever is the value of c1, these parabolas will be shifting. And similarly, this will be the equation when we have theta double dot equal to minus u. Solving this equation, we get this equation. Plotting this, we'll be getting this equation. Now but our system is actually a closed loop system, it has both plus u and minus u. So once we combine these two equations, we'll be getting a closed loop, and the phase portrait of the system will be shown as such. Now as I said to you last time also, if we have a closed loop obtained in a system, that actually corresponds to you can say a vortex, or also we described that a closed loop means limit cycle is exhibited by such systems. So So therefore this satellite will actually be having, will be oscillating, and the output theta will actually be oscillating. It's actually trying to reach zero, but it will never reach zero. It will only oscillate around zero. So one can actually say that this system is, this equilibrium point of the system is actually marginally stable, and we can, this system will only oscillate around the angle zero unless we obtain some, we use a controller that can actually make this system stable. This is one example. So what we have done here is we have solved for x1. We have actually obtained an equation that is that we have actually obtained as this equation that we obtained, from which we have obtained the model of the system, x2 square equal to 2ux1 plus c1. This means that our system dynamics x2 have been plotted with respect to x1 directly. We have not solved for x1t, we have not solved for x2t. We have directly obtained an equation which is which actually relates x1 with respect to x2, and directly we are plotting that equation. So for if you want to see the detailed model of this system, the actual dynamics of the system are governed by this equation, J d square theta by dt square equal to tau. This is the actual dynamic equation of the system. We have written the simplest form of this, that is theta double dot equal to u. We have not taken into consideration this J, that is actually the moment of inertia. You can take J also here. It will not change our equations. It will not, because J for the system will be constant. It will be absorbed by C1 and C2 in both the cases, where T tau is actually the torque, that is the rotational input to this system. So we'll use the same satellite control system and obtain its solution in a different manner now. We'll modify the dynamic equation of the system, and the dynamic equation that we'll be obtaining will also be consisting of the viscous friction coefficient, and we'll be solving that equation. We'll be obtaining for x1 and x2, and we'll be from that plotting x1 with respect to x2. That will be doing in the next session.